after 1.5 months and 48 ODIs, men's cricket finally has a new champion. England and New Zealand took each other on in the final of the ICC Cricket World Cup on Sunday, and England emerged victorious, claiming its first ever World Cup trophy. This was not a regular match. Both the innings were tied. It went on to a super over that was also tied, and then we had to decide the winner on the basis of a boundary count. Now, we've had a lot of talking points come out of this game, right from that Ben Stokes overthrow to the boundary count back rule itself, and that's what we're going to be talking about today.
So the final boiled down to the last over of the match, where England needed 15 runs to win the cup. Kane Williamson turned to his premier fast bowler Trent Boult to defend those runs, and England had Ben Stokes, who had led the recovery for them and had taken them to that point. He was batting on 70 at that stage, and he was running out of partners with only 2 wickets left. So the over went like this: 2 dot balls and a 6 over the leg side. And the next ball was what turned out to be the major talking point of the game, where Stokes hit the ball to the leg side and ran for 2. The New Zealand fielder Guptill took aim at Stokes' end and threw the ball, but the ball accidentally deflected off Stokes' bat on the dive, and it raced to the boundary behind the keeper. That resulted in another 6 to England's total, and the equation came down to 3 of 2 balls. But England could only manage 2 singles of the next 2 balls, and eventually ending up all out due to runouts at the non-striker's end. In result, we had a first tie of the World Cup final. So here's how the overthrow rule works. According to the law 19.8 of the MCC rulebook, if the ball is deflected off the batsman during off a throw and it runs onto the boundary, the 4 runs is counted to the batting side. But in yesterday's instance, when England had set off for a second run, and when Guptill threw the ball, at that point of release, both Stokes and Rashid hadn't crossed at the point of release. So that means after the ball had struck Stokes and run to the boundary, only 1 run from the 2 should have been added to the overthrow 4 runs. So that's where there has been a confusion between the how the score has been tallied towards the end, and a lot of questions have been raised about the umpiring in the aftermath of the final. Former ICC elite panel umpire Simon Toffel pointed out the error in judgment by the umpires at the point of release of the ball from the fielder. But he didn't point out that, like, you know, the error in judgment can happen to anybody, and that it was unfair to castigate the on-field umpires for the entire result of the game. And this is what he said: "It is unfair to say that the World Cup was decided by that one event. There's a lot of what-ifs and what should-be's and what could be that happen of those 600 plus deliveries. That's the nature of the sport."
So considering the scores were tied at 241 each, the match went into a super over, the first of its kind in an ODI World Cup. Now, considering that England had batted second, they were to bat first in the super over, and they brought out Joss Butler and Ben Stokes, who had already gotten into a little bit of a rhythm during the regulation innings itself. And these two were to face Trent Boult on the other end. Now, Trent Boult has had a very patchy sort of a run in the final, and that sort of continued even in the super over. England managed 15 runs in these 6 deliveries, and they set New Zealand a target of 16. Martin Guptill and Jimmy Neesham came out to chase this total, with Jofra Archer facing them at the other end. Jofra Archer, mind you, was brought in quite specifically for this tournament, and there was a lot riding on this young man. Jimmy Neesham, with a 6 and decent running between the wickets, sort of almost got them through. And it came down to New Zealand requiring 2 runs of the last ball. And Martin Guptill was at strike at that time. It was not to be, though, because Guptill struck Jofra Archer to deep mid-wicket. It was fielded there and the ball was thrown back at the striker's end. Joss Butler did what he needed to be, and New Zealand fell 1 run short. Again here, the scores were tied, not just in the regulation, but also in the super over.
So this was the first World Cup where there were rules set in place in case a match in a knockout ended in a tie. And if the Super Over also ended in a tie, the rule was that the winner will be declared on the boundary countback. So the boundary countback is seeing which team has scored the most number of boundaries, including both the regulation innings and the Super Over. And in case both the number of boundaries are similar in that instance, we look at only the boundary scored in the regulation innings.
Considering the fact that both the regulation time innings and the super over scores were tied, the winner had to be decided on the basis of a boundary countback, and this sort of triggered a conversation about whether this was the right way or the fair way to decide a winner. So again, Twitter started talking about numerous other alternatives that we could probably use to decide the winner in cases of a super over tie.
So the first alternative when we have to declare a winner in the event of a tie is we can draw our memory back to the 1999 World Cup semi-final between Australia and South Africa. The match ended in a tie, and Australia was the one who went on to the final because they'd beaten South Africa in the league stages in the same tournament. They could have probably done away with the Super Over. I know Super Over brings in a lot of more excitement to an already exciting finish, but we could have done away with the Super Over and declared a winner based on the league stages of the World Cup, where England had previously beaten New Zealand. Or another thing we could have looked at was the league stage standings between both the sides. Again, England had a better record over New Zealand because they had finished third over New Zealand's position of fourth.
So another alternative, probably, if you ask me, would have been to fall back on the wickets rather than the boundaries. New Zealand had lost 8 wickets in its innings, but England had been bowled out by the New Zealand bowlers. So, I mean, we're all talking about cricket becoming a batsman's game. So again, falling back on boundaries sort of adheres to that narrative. A third alternative probably, and the easiest one perhaps, I mean, considering how things work in other sports like football and tennis, would have been to just have another super over. If you have a tied first super over rather, then the other alternative would have been to just have another over and see who bats the other one out. That would have been the simplest way to get out of a situation like this. Every generation has a match that they probably go on and talk about, they remember fondly at tea time conversations or at breakfast. For me personally, this is going to be one such match. It went down right to the wire. I didn't have fingernails at the end of this game. I had to go somewhere else and watch that final ball. And I don't remember too many games that have given me that kind of a feeling. And I'm sure this is a sentiment a lot of people echo as well. So I think it's only fitting to sort of end with a tweet that Jimmy Neesham had put out. He said, "Kids, take up baking. Don't take up sports. Just die at 60, really fat and happy." That sort of sums up what quite a lot of us felt at the end of the game. But for now, at least until 2023, we're going to have to be happy with the fact that at the end of the day, cricket won. And we have ourselves a new champion. And it's England's time to celebrate. It's come home.